Again, I want to do at least three segments that I thought might be useful and get us all on the same page together. And this will be recorded. John will have this recorded and available.
Yes, I will.
So long after I'm gone, you can laugh whatever you want. So inspections are required. Of course, the reference for this is, of course, the Directive 10-1301, frequency, and this really addresses mostly aviation, that policy. There is a policy for marine, the MARS, which I'm not going into that detail on because we're still working on that area of policy. But SARS, twice a year. And everything else, LARS, contract weather observers, NFOBs, APADES, we only have one that's at Blanding, Utah, and MARS, which is the Marine Observing Station, the Coast Guard sites, those are all once a year. There's a checklist and a report form for everything but the MARS in this directive, and that directive is found at the link I just put in there. And still need to email the observation or the inspection report to FAA points of contact, and then the B33 address. But we also need to upload it to the inspection database, which will be a little bit. I'll get into that in a little bit more detail toward the end of the report. Best practices. Is to go into
Tom?
The yes, sir.
Sorry to interrupt. This is Keith Upgator. Am I the only one whose presentation is not updating? I still got your intro screen.
We should have seen a. I'm on the third slide.
Inspection best updating practices.
Here. I'm not getting anything in Sioux Falls either.
Yeah, I'm good here.
Marquette's updated.
Aberdeen's updated.
Wonder if you guys are having your. Still issues. Which offices were that again, just so I know?
Oh, there. Okay, Keith and Gaylord, but I'm calling in from home. It did just update. I got inspections required now.
It hasn't changed.
Okay, yeah, I know. Sorry about Sioux Falls. I know you guys have been having problems there with your line.
I'll send this out later. The recorded version will probably be what you want to look at because I'm going to be pulling some web pages up that are not part of the PowerPoint. I'm only using about four slides or five slides. But I'll go to the next slide here. This is slide number three, and it's inspection best practices. So really the only one that we are not seeing update is Sioux Falls. Is that right?
That's affirmative.
Okay. Sorry, Don.
No problem.
Hey, Tom.
Yes?
You could send these slides out maybe after the...
Oh, yeah. Yep. Sure.
So everybody will have them. That'd be a great idea.
Right. Definitely want to, before you go out to a site, for aviation sites in particular, is to check against the certificate database, which, give you a real quick update, they lost everything. The server crashed. They had a choice of when they restored it to go with server A or server B. They picked the wrong one. They lost all the data from April to the current time, 2-3 weeks ago. And they had to. I had all the pieces of paper that kind of like a backup. Every time Paula does something, she brings a piece of paper back to me, and I keep that in a little file. I gave that to the IT folks, and they manually typed all those things back in. They wrestled with that a couple iterations, and just as of about an hour ago, we believe the database is good again. Paula's doing her double check, kind of a spot check, and we're looking at all the requests. And she's been holding off on the requests. She's going to start processing those. Give her a little time, and I want you to see if those have been processed that you've requested. But I think we're good to go. At any rate, so you want to check the database, get a printout before you go to a particular station. When you get there, ask for their certificates, and double check your list. You're, you know, responsible to keep who is there and who's not. Cancel the ones that have left. If they moved within your county warning area, you know, of course you're going to transfer them. If they move out of your county warning area, regardless of what they tell you, the guy's going to go to this station, you're going to cancel that person. And we'll go into that in a certificate portion of when I talk to you about that at a different time. What's supposed to happen, and when they show up at the new station, they're supposed to let the new supervising office know they've arrived. They'll double-check to see if the guy was current before he left the other site, and then request a certificate be issued there. So you're basically, when you do your inspection, you want to go out and double-check those certificates, take care of the canceling, and bring in new certificates in. Many times they forget to call you and let you know somebody's arrived. And I would also request that you list on, it's not on anywhere in the writing, in the chapter or the directive or anything, but at the end of the report, list who the observers are at that point. So we can always look back and say, yeah, they were there. Because I've had some people claim to be there. We have our records show they were canceled. This would be another way to double-check, kind of a snapshot along the way. Temperature and dew point's a problem for LARS many times. They were, when they got ASOS, you know, they have backup responsibilities. It includes temperature and dew point. Their order, 7900.5, requires that they have backup. And they bought, my understanding is there's these standalone weather sensors packages, which include temperature, dew point, a DASI, and a wind system sitting in a warehouse. There's, I'm told, like 100 of them. There's no money in the FAA to install them. So we still have a lot of towers that have no backup temperature dew point. And this paragraph is what I would like to have indicated in that section to articulate what we understand the requirement to be, but that there is another statement that says if the element's not available, they don't report it. Kind of a catch-22. Yes.
This is Billy. I have a question on those units that are in a warehouse. Are the LARS sites themselves aware that they're available but not to be installed because of money's problems, or what can I tell locally, the airport that I have under that that meets that description? I'm looking for they could ring themselves to get the thing installed.
Right. And I think that normally a tower manager, the air traffic side, would work with his airway facility side, or they could call the tech ops, technical operations manager, to put it on a list of equipment they want installed. That's my understanding.
But okay, I don't basically think tell the tower managers work with tech ops manager. And,
right.
If you don't have any objections, I'm going to tell them it seems that there are some available. It's up to them to work it out with the FAA.
Right.
Okay, thank you.
But it's my understanding they're not going to get anywhere. You know, it's there's no money, and they're not willing to spend it. I often wondered, I think, you know, like this Peoria problem you've got, whether the airport, if they coughed up whatever or assisted with the trenching and so on, concrete work, they could move this thing forward.
Yeah, that's why I asked, because I was going to tell them that they're available, so that cuts down on having to purchase one, which is what they were looking at. So,
absolutely.
Okay, thank you.
So that's the boilerplate paragraph that I'd like to have put in for our central region inspections if they don't have temperature and dew point. I'm not going to give them an unsatisfactory at this point, but that's the paragraph I'd like to have put in there. Okay, now I'll just, before I go to the database, just look at the inspection checklist is here. Everybody see this new slide except Don? Okay. kind of a complicated checklist. You've got the different categories, the type of facility, ASOS, AWOS manual. They want to know the service level, so you can, you know, articulate that in your text that you're going to type up on the inspection report, and of course the type of station. And then you've got different columns. You've got a column one for non-federal, like SARS, BSARS, SARS-2. Column two would be for LARS, contract observing sites, non-fed OBS, NWS observing sites. And then, of course, and that's with ASOS and AWOS, backup and augmentation. And, of course, then a full manual observation, which we may have a few in the LARS category, but there's so many AWOSs out there, there's very, very few. So you pick the column that's appropriate and then go right down the column. And the I'll also point out here, like in pressure, you have on each one of these elements, you'll have a grace period. For pressure, there's no grace period, period. If they don't have a good altimeter and it's not been approved by FAA, particularly for a SARS, and I say SARS, that includes BSARS and SARS-2, then they're suspended. And they're suspended for typically 30 days or given an action to complete the fix. We can extend it, but normally after 30 days, we close the station. That's a lot of paperwork. If we can try to nudge them toward fixing those problems, then we want to do that as well. Speaking of the altimeter source approval, this is the most important. Somebody's not on mute, and I'm hearing a lot of scratching noise. I don't know. That noise right there. If you could take care of that, I would appreciate it. But let's see here. That's an example. Of an altimeter setting approval. This is one that was issued for Aberdeen Airport, and it was issued by the FAA to the airport authority. Basically, says they've inspected it. They look at the shelf height, the elevation, when it was calibrated, what frequency they transmitted on. So this is an FAA responsibility. It's not Weather Service responsibility. We're out of that business of checking pressure. We check to make sure they do the comparisons. We check to make sure they post the correction. Also check to see if it's been calibrated within the last 24 months. But as long as they've got this letter and it's been calibrated within the last 24 months, that's what we need. The advisory circular that spells this out is the 91-14D. If you'll notice, the date on it is April 1979, has not been updated, and it's still current. Talks about the instrumentation, when it needs to be calibrated within 30 days prior to installation, every 24 months thereafter. The accuracy requirements, and that's, again, this is all FAA requirements. On the last page, you'll notice system approvals must be installed in accordance with this advisory circular. Initial approval and annual inspection should be accomplished by the appropriate FAA office. So if we have a station being established or one that's already in place, this is what we require them to provide to us for that cornerstone of the SAR station. Masaba was a good example. The FAA went through and checked all their sites and found out they weren't being properly calibrated by the repair station they were using. Masaba said, it's too much bother, we're closing them all. several airports and picked it up behind the Mesaba people, but it's not everywhere. In the inspection, we have a policy letter from headquarters that the inspection report database has been developed and the inspections should be documented and put on the database. It's kind of an addition to 10-1301. I think they talk about the form. Okay. Back to the slides. Moving on, any questions on the inspection reports themselves?
You suggest using Firefox?
Absolutely, for the database, yes. And I'll explain why. Do you want to show the form too? The actual form that you would use is downloaded from the headquarters website for forms. Did I put that in the... I meant to put that in the PowerPoint. Yeah, I did. Checklist and report forms are found at the Weather Service headquarters forms. There's the DAD sites, which have a lot of information, but this website that FAA or Weather Service headquarters has the inspection reports, has the training, all kinds of stuff on it. The observing handbook number 8, if a station needs that, but it's also got the inspection forms and the checklist. Looking at the inspection database or inspection report form that you take from your checklist is you put your station in there. These are all blocks that you can type in. Select the whether it's staffed, automated, or a manual site. There's no AWOSes or ASOSes on the airport. Whether it's a complete inspection or a follow-up, and give them a grade. It's got the pretty well prompts you for most of the areas that are from the checklist. Justification for rating. So if you rated it excellent, which I don't recommend very often, sometimes they qualify, but they got to really stand out. Usually most stations are satisfactory. And you're going to put in there why you rated it, because they fully met all the observing requirements and was a well-run station. It would be sufficient element to put in there. Conditionally unsatisfactory is something that it's okay to let them go for another 30 days, like a temperature sensor needs to be replaced. They've got a grace period, but they've got that 30-day window. So you can give them a conditionally unsatisfactory, and then, of course, it requires a follow-up inspection report as well. And then you got the actions with target completion dates, kind of just everything at the top is kind of a summary of the high points of the report. On the other elements here, it'd be good to have one or two sentences just to explain the status. So if somebody's never been to the station, they have a little idea what kind of equipment they're using. They have a SAWS working, or they're using, as an alternative, Kestrel has a temperature dew point sensor that's approved by the Weather Service and FAA for temperature dew point. It's a Kestrall. There are 3,000 or 4,000 typically. Handheld, and it meets all of our accuracy standards. And again, there's no place for observing certificate numbers and names, but I would like to have those listed on here as well. Let me see if there's something else I was going to show you.
Just for the
Okay. Here's an inspection report George Wetzel has done. He gave them a conditionally unsatisfactory, and it was because they have a very difficult job getting to a position where they can view the sky, measure their snow. He wrote a pretty good paragraph in here. There's a safety issue for them walking around on the roof. There's no protection. There's could be ice and snow, but that's their normal sky viewing area. FAA brought in OSHA to review it. OSHA said there's no problem, so we're no longer calling it unsatisfactory, but we're suggesting that it's conditionally unsatisfactory. He's coordinated very closely with me on it, and I would ask the same whoever the person here is. If it becomes a conditionally unsatisfactory or unsatisfactory, work with the person in charge here, because they need to then call Weather Service headquarters, perhaps call the FAA region or focal point, and see what can be done. Let's see. I've got another one. Green Bay. Patrick up there and Dan Clark had done, there's a satisfactory report. And again, they listed the observers. This is something that I like to see there. At the end, let's see here. Following certificates canceled and returned to Central Region. This helps us kind of clean up the database if something falls through the cracks. Okay, as far as the inspection database, there's a user's guide. Hopefully you all have this. It was updated August 31st and sent out. It explains step by step how to make entries into the database. Gives you the link, and again, I think somewhere in here talks about using the Mozilla Firefox to do that. Or it did, I thought. But that's where you go to get to the location. Got examples in here, how to fill things in, initial setup procedures. I have authorized all the OPALs and all the DAPMs in the region and a few other people at the request of each of the WFOs if you have other people that normally do the inspections and make the entries. It is a protected database requiring your email address and your password to get in. Typically, we can look at this in the actual database. If you're going to add a site, you're going to pick the region, the station number, the ID, what kind of a station. It's a pull-down menu. You have a choice. Phone number, an alternate number. If it's a particular agency like FAA, who the FAA program implementation manager is. That's going to be either Robert Tomko for most of the region or Kent Curran in Wyoming and Utah and in Colorado. The manager, the points of contact, and the frequency is the frequency of how often you visit the station, annual or semi-annual. Or to be, current inspection, you're going to put the date in there. We'll look at that a little bit later. So it explains all the procedures of how to put those in. So doing an inspection, for example, I've got this frequency. Let's see what this says here. That's come up before. Let's go to the actual the slide again. Mozilla Firefox, we talked about that. Use your email and access code or password to sign in. FAA has access. We'll be reviewing the LARS and contract observer inspections. They're being kind of weaned into this process, so it's kind of a limited basis at this point. That's really all the slides I have.
Okay, any questions for Tom?
Well, wait a minute, I'm not done. I'm going to go into the actual database itself.
Oh, I mean before you went on.
That's what I was asking. Any questions, I guess, at this point?
So you said Mozilla. I haven't had any trouble with Explorer.
You can look at it, but uploading files, I've heard a lot of problems with uploading files.
I always upload PDFs, and they go fine.
Good luck. If you want to use Internet Explorer, go ahead and give it a try. But if you have problems, it's probably because of Internet Explorer, and they recommend Firefox.
Would you prefer uploading a certain type file or not?
Not really.
PDF.
PDF is good. It's very stable. It cleans up all the shaded areas. So you could really print to Adobe PDF if you have that capability. If you don't, you can get that capability from your IT people, have it loaded on your computer. You need Adobe Acrobat. I would think sometimes Word has a capability of printing or exporting to a PDF as well. But this is what the database looks like. It's got everybody in the country on it. So we'll go down here. For example, Aberdeen, we've got he's got two stations. We got the SARS at Aberdeen as well as the one at Pier. And I'm not sure if, yeah, he's, Tim's been in there keeping his up to date. So typically you'll find all the information about the station in here, contact for the airport manager, the frequency of the visits, current inspection, and the next inspection. So it's kind of a prompt. And I'll show you how we use that. The last inspection was satisfactory. Gives a little bit of travel time and distance and the time it took to do the inspection. Down here, we've got the inspections. There's one document loaded in here. There's also the A1, A3, the metadata. There's nothing loaded in this at this time. It's an active site. If he were to put in a site that was unsatisfactory, it would go to a pending area where I would have to review it before it gets posted, and that's where the document approved question comes into play. But for example, we click on the document, I can open it up, and I can see the inspection report. So it's everything's in there that that we need. Back to the summary. I go in here and I've got pending. I've got no inspections here that are conditionally unsatisfactory or unsatisfactory that I need to see. If I want to see, for example, the last inspections, this will just be for my region. For example, there's Pier in Aberdeen. They're current. The next inspections are due, and they're kind of getting close, so they're in a different color. This again, works for most of these. And I know a lot of you have not started using this, and I'm requesting that you do. This is a requirement of headquarters. This is where the repository for all inspections are. A lot of people are going to be looking at this, including the FAA. I can export to a spreadsheet. I have access to an administrative area where I've got the list of people that are approved to get in here and edit. So if you need to be added, I just need to know. if you want your MIC to be able to view, and I think I put all the MICs in here too, that capability is available. But let's just try adding a station just as an experiment to kind of see how we're doing this. So we're going to pick which WFO. I'm going to pick CRH since it's, and I'll start, just make this up, test city. And it's going to be, let's make it a contract observer, 816. Agency, FAA, the PIM, I'm going to pick central since it's the center part of the country. That's going to be most of the offices except for Colorado, Wyoming, and Utah. Ohio would also be east, but right now we're not worried about. No, actually, it's great. Yeah, it's still east, but we don't have any stations there that I'm aware of. And then we got Joe. I'm not going to be real particular here. The manager's email, joe@aol.com. And it wasn't very good. What was it? That could be the same frequency, annual. And the current inspection, let's just say 10 and submit. Now we can edit that station. By finding it. On the list. Is this Tim? Are you on, Tim Kearns or Larry?
Yeah, I'm here.
Is this pretty well the same view that you see?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Yes, yes.
All right. So we're going to put a inspection, current inspection. We're going to say it's. I'm going to give it conditionally unsatisfactory. It was a point-to-point trip, 50 miles. No, we don't have to write miles in there, do we? 1 hour. And we were there for 1 hour. It cost $0. You could say in here... station given 30 days to car. It's active. I don't see a place in mine here to upload us the report. Inspections. Can we go down here and see if we can find it here? Test city. We're going to upload a report. I'm going to use one I'll use the one I just showed you. I guess I got to do all this again. Conditionally unsatisfactory, trip type, point to point, 51. And I'm not going to write anything in there. And we upload it. Now, so you're done. When I go look at this, I should be able to find. Test city, I could look at it. It's got conditionally unsatisfactory in red. There is a document. It has not been approved, as you'll see that. Now, if I go back to my main list, I look at pending. I see Central City sitting there, and I will go ahead and download it, read it, and then when I want to approve it, I'll come in here and approve the document, and I'll submit it. Then it's in there ready to view. Go back down here again. So now it's got a document listed in there. I can look at it. Kind of how it works. There are a bunch of, obviously, this database needs to be cleaned up. Your area of authority, of course, in these documents are with your call letters, you know, your WFO identifier and your stations. If there are ones that are no longer active, we need them closed. If you see something that you know you have a new SARS there that isn't on here, you need to add it. Because I don't keep my files up here in paper much anymore. So whenever I get asked, this is where I'm going to go to. This is all taken initially from a database we had here that hasn't been kept up very well since Phi Capel was here. So it's been a while. So appreciate all the work that's been done to update this now, and we just need to complete this to have our region completely fresh. If you were going to, and again, we'll get into the A1A3 metadata at a later session. Any questions?
Hey, Tom, on that one at Davenport, I've got doubles on some of those airports. What am I supposed to do with those?
So like Davenport here, this one?
I have two Moline's, two Cedar Rapids, two Dubuque.
I only see one here. Oh, I see two Dubuque's. Which one's right?
The one with the information in it. I only put information in one of them. I don't know what to do with the other one. It came to me with doubles on everything.
Okay. All right. So this one, you haven't got much information in. And the other Dubuque, you have nothing in. So we want to delete. So you go up here to add, edit, and delete. Come down here to the Dubuque that's the second one. And I think this is the one that doesn't have any data in there. I don't see how to delete it either. Make it a no at the bottom on this active area.
Okay, I can do that.
So the ones that are not supposed to be in there, just turn it to an inactive and submit. Go back to the summary. DVN. Now we've only got one Dubuque in there. Okay. Good question. Anybody else?
Tom, this is John in Grand Junction.
Hey, John.
What are we supposed to do with our office-owned DigiCords?
I've got a list right now. Just hang on to them. Let the ETs use them if they want. They're on our property. I haven't attacked that problem. I do have the list of what people have sent to me, and I'm hoping to get to that before I leave.
Okay. Thanks.
I appreciate the question.
Tom?
Yes.
Is there going to be a faux Tom next month or the month after? You're the only administrator, right?
I am.
So are they going to hopefully assign someone to do that duty in the interim, I hope?
I hope so.
So it seems like this is something you can't just forget about.
Agreed.
Okay.
Maybe John Ice for the interim.
Are you there, John?
What? No, I'm just kidding. I heard you. Yeah, that's a good point. We'll have to get together, make sure that's taken care of.
I'm not sure this aviation duties are moving over to SSD. It's just co-op and upper air, is my understanding.
Yeah, we don't know.
So it's still in limbo. This is kind of, but I'm trying, guys, to
but we'll try to
find out what they're thinking is.
Okay, to me this looks like something that you just can't.
I know.
It seems like something's going to take a little bit of time to get to learn it, and you can't just sit and say, here you go.
Right.
Especially since there's no one else that knows it. So, and I'll just say one other thing that you didn't really mention a thing. If we upload in PDFs, you can attach different documents and files and pictures, and you can attach quite a bit of stuff to whatever you upload, and it really shrinks down the size, and it makes them a very versatile document.
I agree with that.
Okay, if you would like to, I don't know how many people are still on. My Springfield one.
25.
My Springfield one we just recently did, if you would want to pull that up, you can see what you can do with a PDF. I don't have my observers because my database has been locked up since I've done the
Springfield
cleanup on that. Yes, sir. Springfield SGFRs, yes.
Okay.
And you're also going to upload your B-33s for your upper air station inspections and B-48s on that. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. And you all have to do that from Central Region, I will assume, since it's a regional inspection.
Yeah. The WFOs themselves, and I'm just going to go back here to the summary, and I need to clean this up. I haven't done this myself. For example, looking at Bismarck WFO right there. That's a Central Region site. It's because I need to change that to CRH.
Okay, you did on mine. You didn't on some. I went.
I know. I haven't done them all.
Did it. Just to see,
I will go
see
in
how they work.
CRH, and I'll put the
that's quite
the
a bit of work to
see name and all that stuff. I'll
clean
I'll
all
populate
that stuff
all the WFOs.
But again, with my Springfield one, I attached like half dozen pictures to it too, and it still was well below the as far as the file size when I converted it to a PDF. It was well below the maximum. I think it's 1.2 meg that you can upload or something.
Something like that.
Yeah.
While you're waiting for that to load up, I have a question. If you accidentally hit download a document and you want to get rid of it, is there a way?
Right now you have to call me, and I'll have to call headquarters.
Okay, thanks.
It can be done. I'm supposed to be given that permission. I don't think it's there yet.
That's the wrong one. That was number two. That was dot two. That was a B-48 I loaded right there.
All right.
Doc 1 should be the PDF.
It is. PDF loading up here. What's convenient about a PDF, it does create a smaller file size. It cleans up everything, all the shaded areas. And you're able to add pictures, which sometimes is very effective When you do inspections, also something I didn't mention before, if you're going to a contract observing site, they do the surface observation program. They have their visibility charts. You're going to check those, make sure they're reasonable, have them update them if they don't appear to be accurate. Again, we're not going to go out and measure for them. It's the kind of thing that it's their responsibility to create the document using Google or airport diagrams or whatever to find out distances. Some county maps are very good. But you need to go to the tower because they enter tower visibility. That's a component of the METAR. So you need to make arrangements to go to the tower and then look at their visibility charts. That's about all you're going to do up there. You should ask them for they used to have visibility-only certificates in the tower. They don't have, and it's being debated by general counsel and headquarters, they don't have tower visibility certificates anymore. They have a database, like a CVT. Computer-based training database. Have them print out, which they should be able to do, the certificates that are issued and current for those tower visibility observers in the tower. It's part of the total observation.
We no longer have to initial and date those visibility charts, correct?
That's correct.
Been gone for a while, that requirement?
Yeah, it's not in our directive that we have that responsibility. We may want you to.
But it's in the checklist, Tom.
It's on the checklist. Tom, we don't initial them anymore. We make a note of it in the checklist that it's current. That will be reflected in our report. Initially, it's not in the checklist, as I recall. Is that what you were saying, Larry?
Yes.
You're saying it does say to initial it?
No, it does not.
That's what I thought.
Just check them.
Okay.
Well, this is Byron in Boulder. You know, I'm getting a call annually from the tower folks, and they actually want me to initial and date their visibility markers. I guess there wouldn't be anything wrong with that, would it? I mean, all the tower folks in my CWA would like to have those visibility markers initialed annually and dated.
We're not required to. You do, that's up to you. We evaluate that they appear to be accurate.
Oh, yes.
We write it up in our report. Pardon?
Yes, I've actually had a couple of sites that actually have done a magnificent job on their visibility markers. They've actually taken aerial photos and then just drew mile markers around and then pinpointed what markers they are using. So I think they've done a great job on that. But again, like I said, they're asking me annually to come up and certify and date their visibility charts. And I guess there wouldn't be anything wrong with that, would it?
I'll check for you, Byron. I would prefer you say that we don't initial them anymore.
Okay, I could do that. That's no problem.
I would prefer that takes the legal liability off your back.
Okay, that's no problem. I can do that from now on.
What we do is evaluate that they look reasonable,
mm-hmm.
that a person that's new to the station can come on and easily pick up by looking at this visibility chart and start taking observations, that they're clearly marked in the distances, the lighted water tower, so on and so forth.
Right.
That's about all we are doing.
Okay, well, that's good, because that had been on me to get an airport badge because of going up and certifying those visibility.
You still need to go up and evaluate them, so you have that responsibility.
All right, I can do that still also.
Okay.
I just don't want to have to go through all these background checks again.
Right. So I'm going to go ahead and, for example, into this one. I just created this goofy one. I'll go in here
mm-hmm.
and make it inactive. Get rid of it. It's gone.
Now, if you make it inactive, do you have to create from scratch again?
Does
it never, never land?
Probably, because I don't think you're going to find it.
Okay.
It's not there anymore. Yes. Any questions on that? I don't have any more. Again, this is the policy letter that says we will use the inspection database, and they're planning to end the B33 address when they see this database well populated.
But we still send there until notified.
Until notified, right.
It may never be well populated until the B33 is activated.
I know. I need to check on that before I get too far down the road and see what the latest on that is. Make a note to do that.
Tom, when are you retiring?
December 30th. Friday, December 30th is my last day.
And I'm going to miss you.
I want to miss you and everybody, and I tell you, it's
hired back as a contractor.
Yeah, why don't you suggest that?
Yeah, what you don't know is we tore up your retirement papers.
Oh. Well, I wouldn't mind coming back to help. I know Steve Schultz has done that. He works like 40 hours a month. I'd be happy to do that if they wanted to for a while.
That no, they can't replace you anyway, Tom.
Everybody's replaceable. Everybody's replaceable.
Haven't you been there longer than anyone currently, Tom?
I have. Next will be Tom Schwein.
Wow.
I do believe.
How about Methuselah?
Just about. Probably older than that one.
Hey, you've been a great guy, Tom. You've been a great guy.
I hope so. You know, I'm not perfect. So
I
apologize
for things
I've left
you
on the floor. And
somebody visit you.
You know what? That's a good idea. If
what?
You stick around a while, you may become perfect.
We're talking about the weather service now.
Yeah. Is there anything I can help you guys with? Is there any topics that you would like to have explored and talked about in the next couple months?
You mentioned A1s and A3s would be nice.
I will do that.
Thank you.
Hey, Tom, one area that it's written nowhere, and I don't see any template for any of this stuff, but just you do a fantastic job with your interaction with the FAA and any other agencies, but maybe if you had set aside some time on discussions with different points of contact in these agencies, what to do and what certainly not to do, maybe.
Okay. All right.
That's good stuff, Billy.
Now, all these slides will be available after this call, correct?
Yeah, I think John,
I'll make it available.
Edit these. This portion that I've done out of the total recorded session and make it a separate standing package.